Welcome to Modern Musings, conversations with the Maven, Mother, and Crone, looking at ourselves and the world through the lens of the 21st century. Hello and welcome back. I'm your hostess, Kristen Hessler, and I'm here with my co-hosts, Amber Jones and Cindy Murray.
Hello.
Hello. You hesitated there.
I know. I was like, let me make sure I get this right.
I know, right?
So today, we're actually, before I introduce our topic today, we're celebrating. We got brand new microphones and brand new microphone stands. Woo. And we just tested out like a fake podcast. And it was pretty cool because it hopefully you can tell the sound quality is a lot better. We were renting microphones for audio for like musical instruments and, you know, for like bands and stuff. And so now we actually have like
some, yeah, they were
spoken word type microphones.
Yes.
So.
We actually have actual podcasting microphones.
Yeah, we have actual like microphones that don't fall over in the middle of speaking.
Right. Or, and the stand doesn't gradually like get lower
just drop
over time.
Drop. Yeah. And there's not a big pop screen in front of our faces
that
we keep
worst.
Lifting our heads.
I kept
over.
Wanting to like look because we're sitting in like a little triangle so we can look at each other while we talk. And, I would always like kind of reach around because it was, like,
was
in
really
my
bad.
Face and mom would always like hand signal me to get back in front of my microphone. So hopefully you will find that the audio experience of the podcast is more pleasurable and the popping sound is less.
Just don't try to intentionally pop. That.
Yes, I'm going to try not to.
Yes.
So, but anyways, so that was our little celebration today. I just wanted to let you know if the sound quality sounds better. That's why.
Yeah.
So, today we are talking about tips for a successful job interview.
Tips for a successful job interview.
Oh, I just said it again because the first time it went.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Tips for a successful job interview.
Let me
repeat myself. Tips.
Tips.
How am I not myself? No. Anyway, so if you listen to a previous podcast, that's an inside joke.
Yes. Go listen to the I Heart Huckabees.
Yeah. Anyways, so yes, tips for a successful job interview. So we'll be giving the tips to each other, I guess, and maybe like thinking up what we think would be good tips. And just from our personal experience, we have different backgrounds in our interviewing experiences. So, you know, I was thinking of this topic because the workforce dynamic right now is completely different and it's continually evolving. The types of people, and Amber's got like deer in the headlight eyes. Companies are looking for different types of qualities in the candidates when they're interviewing than they did, you know, 20 years ago or even like 5 years ago.
Right.
With post-COVID, you know, one of the things that people really look for is like independent workers that can work from home.
The ways that they find
and the ways that they find people. Absolutely.
Completely,
you didn't have to go beat the pavement anymore, really. I mean.
Well, it doesn't do you any good to go beat the pavement, I guess is the point.
No company hires walk-ins. Like,
no.
They don't
no. In
let
fact,
you
they will
fill in an application.
No,
or
they
anything.
Will tell
Unless
you
it's
to
a
go
job
online.
Fair.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, if it's a job fair, then they'll hire walk-ins.
But that's how most companies are hiring now are through employment agencies.
Yeah, a lot of
Or
through an online,
website,
or they have an online.
So like Indeed and Glassdoor.
Can thank Monster for that. That's the first one I ever thought of because
I remember
going through the
Monster,
newspaper and looking for the jobs that were in the newspaper. Mm-hmm. And luckily,
as a kid,
and luckily they were posted
teenager.
Online at that point. Like on the Dallas Morning News, that's where I searched for work.
Oh, well, you're from
Monster.
A bigger area. Like my small town of Vernon, like I had to like actually go to the unemployment office as a teenager and they knew who was hiring and then they would send me to go hit the pavement in those places.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was, I mean, that's very similar to my experience growing up in Lubbock. You know, if you wanted a job, you kind of knew what kind of companies you wanted to go for. You know, if I wanted a fast food job, I would just go to every fast food restaurant that was close to me and fill out an application. Sometimes you could look in the paper, but not always, you know, not a lot of those kind of jobs were not even listed in the paper. Mostly right. What was in the paper were secretarial, clerical,
professional
positions and stuff. And you know, nowadays, like I said, you can't walk into any business, even like Walmart or something like that. They don't have
paper applications
anymore. You have to go online and fill out that application.
Well, I remember Target used to have a kiosk that they would point
they
you
were
to,
like
but
the first place I'd ever filled out a kiosk application.
I don't
actually.
Think they have it anymore. I think you actually have to go online from your house,
which is interesting, because then that means you have to have computer access,
right? Which is, and that can be a drawback for people, you know, who are looking for work who don't have internet access. You know, if you don't have a job, how are you paying for internet? You know,
then so it's, 2024, like, not everybody still has a computer
exactly.
or a cell phone. Or a cell phone. Most definitely, you just have to go to the local library.
The library,
use their internet.
Well, and honestly, you say it's 2024, people don't have computers. I think a lot of people are not getting computers when they could just have a cell phone and get most of the stuff done with a cell phone.
So true. Yeah. It's hard sometimes if you want to fill out something complicated or
it
write
really is.
Something
it's really
complicated.
Oh, yeah.
Really
I hate filling out forms on my phone. I absolutely will come home and do stuff online on my computer instead. I don't think employers think about those things necessarily when they're thinking about how, you know, hiring people. I don't think they think about that.
You know, interesting thing, my company, actually, you fill out the application on the day that you come in for your interview. It's all by resume only. You submit your resume, and then based on your merit on your resume, they will determine if we will interview you. Then when you come in for the interview, you fill out the application.
Right.
So
a lot of companies are just going to that, and then they're having AI scan resumes looking for keywords and to give them a list of people to interview.
And that, you know, that goes back to the thing of companies using hiring services, you know, like Monster or Indeed or whatever. Yeah. So the problem with that is getting your resume in front of a real person, because you might have a great resume, but if you don't use the exact keywording that they're looking for, it's not even going to, it's just going to kick you out automatically. Mm-hmm. And there's so many people out there looking for jobs who can't even get in front of a real person. But if they could get in front of a real person, they would be, you know, infinitely hireable. But they can't get that can't get past the resume.
You know, and I think we are kind of putting the cart before the horse by talking about interviews. When honestly, like, a resume is a really big, important part of that process that
absolutely.
I think a lot of people are still missing out on those skills. Definitely recommend.
They don't really teach them in school.
Yeah, they do, but at the same time, there's so much ability to go askew from the basic format because it's supposed to be the most basic text-only correct format.
Right. But there's some misinformation out there about what is appropriate, the rules. And I think the rules change from employer to employer sometimes too. Let me give you a little background from me, because I used to work in HR and we did deal with resumes and things like that. And when I was going to school, when I was working, when I was in the workforce, when I was, you know, part of HR and we were, you know, scanning resumes or whatever, there were very strict rules about, you know, what kind of font you could use.
Yeah.
They need to be very professional. You know, you highlight these things and you bold these things and you only put this, and it should be only one page long. and all these other things, and it should be on like a really nice linen paper and blah, blah, blah. Well, of course, nowadays they're all submitted electronically, so that doesn't matter. But there was really particular rules about what your resume should be like. And then there, we went through this phase where it was okay for them to be longer than one page. And that was what the message that they were telling people was, it's okay to have more than one. It's okay to have, well, originally you were supposed to have three personal references on them. Now they don't want the they don't want any references on there. They
not
just want,
that.
Want them on the resume. They only want your work experience, your education, and your skills. What can you bring to the table? And that's all they want on there. That's what gets the door open. And they don't want your professional references. They don't want your personal references. And a lot of times they don't even want any of your personal extracurricular, whatever you want to call it, activities.
Not anymore.
Which those things used to be. And so I think there's a lot of people that are still going by those old rules. Or they're going by the rules of the 90s and the aughts that where they
right.
were making
and
them
how
longer.
Do you know, like, when you're writing your resume, if the person you're sending it to is pre or post?
Right, yeah. Right. So there's a lot of ambiguity there.
I think a lot of people forget the cover letter is a really good place to add those personal touches.
Oh yeah, yes,
because
it is.
That's where you're.
Well, and a lot of people don't do
selling yourself right there.
Well, and a lot of people don't even do a cover letter.
No,
you know?
Yeah, that's the one thing I think people are missing out on is a cover letter.
Right, because that's where you say, you know, this is who I am. This is what I do. Mm-hmm. This isn't my only passion. You know, you fill in that information. Yeah,
and that is one thing that I think should be emphasized more when taught to kids is that you do need. That people will read the cover letter first.
Right.
And, you know, I wasn't taught how to do a resume or cover letter in my school. I had to go, I mean, I guess they kind of touched on it in college, but I had to go on the internet and look for examples and talk with counselors at college to get these examples on how, especially a teaching,
right,
like a teaching resume, which is different than a normal person's resume.
Well, and that's true too. Depending on what kind of job you're,
you have to do your resume to fit the job.
It's not a one size fits all anymore. It's very much geared toward what you're applying for. You know, so.
That's a whole different ball game right there, teaching resumes and cover letters.
I agree.
And now you have LinkedIn, where you can actually put all of your work history information, and it can be validated.
Right.
I really like that because then, you know, on a resume, if you're trying to keep it on one page, but your LinkedIn can have, like, miles of information about you.
Right. You can have personal information and
the only thing I didn't like about LinkedIn was that people could vouch for you. I can't forget what it was called. I don't even know if they still do it. It's been a long time.
Oh, yeah, with your skills, where people can say.
So, like, I could say I'm proficient in Excel.
Right.
Right? And then I had people that I was connected with on LinkedIn that didn't know me in a professional manner, but in other ways, like in circles that I'm in, like in my hobbies. And I had someone vouch for me on that, and it actually kind of irritated me because I'm like,
they didn't know.
You've never seen me use an Excel spreadsheet, and that kind of bothered me. Their heart was in the right place, but I felt like now that just shows me that that is actually absolutely useless.
It waters down the information.
It really does, because those people actually can't say. If, like, someone just picked up the phone and called them and asked them, they wouldn't have anything to say. They wouldn't be able to validate that with anything. Like, I've seen her create these really cool, you know, spreadsheets.
Right.
So with all of those things combined together, those are the things you can do before you get to that interview process.
Right.
Really take the time to spend to craft your resume, picking the right words. It's kind of like a poem or a haiku. You use a very little amount of words to get a big point across.
Right.
So, you know, working on your resume. A big tip for me is always have your resume ready. I have a family member whose company just closed their doors and they needed to start from scratch again because it had been so long since they'd had a resume.
Mm-hmm.
that it was like, oh man, I need to go and add a bunch of stuff. Like, I've worked on these projects and have all these new job skills.
Right. And so it took several days.
Yeah.
To get all that information together. So you should always keep your resume up to date.
Oh my God, I haven't made a resume in like a decade. I'm actually just as bad. Like,
I'm worse than that. So
yeah. You never know. It's like kind of being prepared when the jobopolix happens, when you need a new job.
When the what?
Jobopolix.
Job.
Oh gosh. Okay.
Jobmageddon.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah.
So you never know when you have to like suddenly be prepared with a resume. So.
Right.
But back to the main topic, which was a successful job interview. Question for you both. Have you ever been in an interview that you felt just didn't go well? And why?
You know, I don't think that I ever have. I've never left an interview where I was just like, oh my gosh, I am not going to get this job.
Honestly, I have not either, because every job I actually wound up getting an interview for, mm-hmm. I got the job. So
yeah, and then my last job, I got the job, like, they called me like an hour later and offered me the job.
Yeah, I've been hired on the spot on an interview, which was pretty cool. Two times that I went to an interview, the current job that I'm in, I went to the interview in maybe January or February. And I had actually been through like two phone calls prior where they like pre-screened me, pre-interviewed me. And so I was really thinking like, oh, I got this job. And when I went to the interview, I even felt like I got the job. And they called me back a few days later to tell me that they picked the other candidate. And I was really bummed out about it. But then they ended up calling me back like 6 months later. Mm-hmm. It was less than 6 months later, but it was like a ways later. So I was really thankful that they like, you know, kept my resume, because I had no idea. Like, it really felt like I was going to get hired based on my interview. One time I went to an interview, and this leads me into my first tip. So my first interview that I just was like, I'm not getting this job. And it was because I decided I didn't want to work there. So there's some red flags. And let me tell you, when you're out there looking for jobs and you're filling out applications, if they ask for money, that's not a job.
What?
Yeah.
What are
people
you talking
fall
about?
For that. Like, you're going to apply for a job and then they say,
oh,
you have to make a down payment
or
something. Yeah, that is not a real job. Do
that
not
is
fall
not
for
a
that.
Job.
But what? This is scammers. It's scammers. Yeah. So don't go for jobs like that where they tell you have to pay for $5 for your uniform in advance or make a deposit or anything like that to hold your spot for the interview.
That's
don't
crazy.
Fall for that. The other one is if it's at someone's house, don't go.
Yeah.
Look at the address. We have the ability now to like look at an address
and
see like if
just
it's a
Google
legit
Maps.
Place.
Google Maps is wonderful.
The interview should be held at the place of the business or in a Zoom meeting. It should not happen at a coffee shop or.
Well, I think that
maybe,
depends.
Maybe. I don't know.
I think that depends.
But just be careful because people are scamming
too. Well,
you have to be careful.
Yeah,
and that's what I'm getting at is scammers. And so I went on one. I didn't realize it was a house until I actually arrived there because I was like driving all over trying to find it and I couldn't find the business. And then I realized, oh, maybe it really is this house. So I went to the house. And then they invited me in, and it was two people, and I was like, oh, that's weird, but not weird, because I've seen, you know, and then they interviewed me, and it was a freaking, like, pyramid scheme, multi-level marketing, and that really upset me. Like, I was really upset, because I was actually in, like, a really dark place. I had been laid off from my job, and I was desperate for a job, so there, you know, there was desperateness there. Just, I was, like, willing to work anywhere, and so that leads me to my tip, which is research the company before you go.
Oh, that's absolutely.
Yes.
If you know the name of the company, you should always research.
You should know about the company that you're applying for. And the reason why also, so that you have a successful interview, not just so that you don't show up to an interview that's not for a real job like me, but so that you actually have.
You know what you're getting into. You need to know.
Because they're going to ask you. They are absolutely going to ask you. One of the common questions that people ask is, you know, why are you applying for this company? What do you know about our company? Are you familiar with the role?
And they want someone who has at least done a little background, a little bit of legwork. And I want to go back to your thing about not going to someone's house, though, because there are people who conduct business from their home.
Right. But if that's what the business is, then you're already expecting that.
Right. Right.
See, yeah. I want to say that I did.
Because I know someone who has a, I mean, well, I have a, I work from home.
Yeah. Right. And if so if I hired another agent, working for someone who works from home as their assistant or a part of their startup company, and you know they don't have like a brick and mortar shop yet, then you already know.
Well, that's true.
That's why that's why I'm saying get to know the company.
Right.
I blindly showed up for an interview for a job and I didn't even know what the job was.
Well, and that's the bad thing there. You should always know what you're applying for. Don't just apply for any old
job. It was entry level marketing is basically what it said, and it was no.
Well, that was your first clue. If it says entry level marketing, that's a sales job,
right? Well, I knew that. I thought it would be a call center kind of thing, and they talked about they would supply, you know, the phones and and things like that. But it was really like this thing where you bought like you paid like $1,000 to get like the software and
my
the phone and all the stuff.
Fell for something like that, like a work from home software.
And
whatever,
this was back
job.
When work from home jobs were not common. This was like 2007.
Right. Well, but I mean, like I was saying before, though, you know, even before I became a travel agent, I knew I had friends who were travel agents who had an agency from their home, and they had multiple agents that came to the office in their home. They had a section of their home that had an exterior door for the travel
agency.
Yeah,
I've been there
before. Yeah. And so, I mean that. But like you said, it's about knowing what you're getting into,
right?
And that's the other pre-interview thing is don't just apply for every job. Know what you're getting into. Know what you're applying for. Because
there are a lot of scams on Indeed now, too, or just any of those websites. There are a lot of scam positions.
Yeah, but definitely don't waste your interviewer's time by showing up to apply for a job that you
don't even know what it
is. Don't even know what it is, because what if the job isn't even right for you?
Right.
You want to do a little bit of research, find out if the company is a place you would want to work for. But don't be afraid to ask those questions, you know. When
they set up the interview, or
absolutely.
You could say, you know, I'm not finding stuff on you online. What does this position entail?
What can you tell me about? The position. Don't be afraid to ask what the salary or the rate is.
That is something that people are afraid to do sometimes.
They are.
We're afraid to look.
We're afraid, mighty.
We are afraid to look the gift horse in the mouth or bite the hand that feeds us. So we oftentimes want to wait for them to tell us what the rate is. But sometimes that rate is negotiable based on what you ask for.
It is. Yeah.
So if you lowball yourself too, then you're just setting yourself up for not being paid.
Yeah, and I hated always filling out those job applications where it asked you, what would you like to make? And I'm just like, this is a trick question, because if I lowball myself,
then you're not going to get
offered. I'm not going to get what I want. And then if I highball, then it's like, well, they're too expensive. They don't.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's weird.
We're not going to hire them because we can't meet their needs.
Doing that research ahead of time let you know what the standard rate of pay is for that position.
Right.
Knowing what the position is and doing a little research, a little legwork to figure out what is the common pay scale for that job. And then you can kind of set your sights on somewhere reasonable within that range. And it's okay to say this is negotiable. You know, you can set it a little bit on your – This is my high. I would like to make X number of dollars, but I'm willing to start for less if I have the potential to make more money in the long run.
Right.
And that's always a good question to ask. when you are at the interview is what is the potential to move up in the company. Job interviewers like
because
that question.
They want to know that you are interested in staying there,
mm-hmm.
and you're interested in providing more than just this
temporary
one
fix.
Job.
Yeah. Right. Or just coming here until you find the next best thing. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Definitely people are looking for someone that's passionate about the company.
Right.
Knows what they want and is willing to negotiate. And they also want people that are self-aware, working on their personal development, independent, self-reliant, I guess you could say. One of the questions that I really like that is asked in an interview is, talk about your strengths or weaknesses.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes they'll ask in an interview, explain a time that you failed in the workplace and how you overcame that failure.
See, I hate those questions. I hate the strengths and weaknesses question because people are so like it's one of those questions where you think about, well, should I be honest?
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. You should be honest.
Well, but then it's
prepared
too
to answer.
Honest.
Right.
Like it's just you do have to prepare that answer ahead of time because you know that's the
right
question that they're going to ask.
Here's my answer. My weakness is attendance. Mm. And I will flat out tell my employer that I am passionate about being at work and you will always find me there. I'm not the type to call in, but I'm always running behind the clock in a lot of things in my life. And that's because I try to do as much as I can in every little minute that I can.
Yeah.
And so one of my strengths is also one of my weaknesses because I try to do it all. And I oftentimes get so in the moment and whatever I'm working on that time flies by. Or I go, ooh, I have 2 minutes. I don't want to be idle during those 2 minutes. So I try to find something to occupy mm-hmm. that's productive. And then oftentimes that ends up snowballing into me being 1 or 2 minutes late or a little behind the clock
right.
for the day, you know. And I'm not necessarily the type of person to like just sit and be doing nothing at work. That's definitely not me. You know, and I like to explain that because one of my strengths is also a weakness. So I'm being honest that, like, if anything that you find in me that would ever need coaching, it's going to be my attendance because I'm sometimes 5 minutes late.
Right. Well, and I think what
I'm aware of that.
And I think what they're looking for, they're not just looking for you to show that you're flawed, but they also are looking for you to give your weakness, but also to recognize that these are some ways I can work on that.
Yeah.
I am working on that. So like for me, my weakness is that I often get overwhelmed because I take on too much and it's very difficult for me to ask for help when I need it. And so when someone would ask me that, the answer to that is that I tend to take on too much. And then I get overwhelmed and I forget or I fail to ask for help. And the answer to that is that if people can check on me every once in a while and help me, you know.
You're offering them a solution to help them overcome whatever
right.
deficit there
right.
is.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I'm saying if you will just check in on me from time to time and make sure I'm not biting off more than I can chew or whatever. Just check in and make sure that I am doing, then I'm fine. Because as long as someone has my back, then I am, mm-hmm. I can overcome this flaw, but I know that this is my flaw and this is what I'm going to do.
Right.
And I think that's what they're looking for, you know, not just what your flaw is, but what you think would help you overcome that.
Mm-hmm. Or how they might apply that in this position.
Right.
So, like, next time you fill out a application and do a job interview, you know, if that's a question that you don't like, I would suggest being prepared for that one, because
oh, absolutely.
When you answer that one without trying to answer it too much, then they may try to get more information out of you, and you don't want to come unprepared, right? So that I am all about. It seems weird, like, oh, I don't want to practice interview questions with somebody. That
oh no, but
weird.
It is,
like,
really is a good
it
idea.
It really is helpful,
really is,
because
a good idea.
I mean, even if you don't, like, memorize your answers, just practicing talking about it is going to help you remember these things, so that when you
because you want to say it naturally, you want it to be the natural part of the conversation.
Oh, because there's nothing worse about having to stop and think about something when they ask you a question and you don't know the answer, because that 5 seconds of you thinking feels like a lifetime, because they're just staring at you.
And then you're going to stumble over your words, and you're not going to be
not going to get your point across. Yeah.
And I do, I like having the answer, not memorized, but knowing it by heart, so that you can explain yourself. Yeah.
Yeah. And I like the one with, tell me about a time when you failed, because you can really talk about the lesson that you learned in that failure,
right?
Because
and
that doesn't mean you're a failure now. It just means that there was something that
and that's what they're
happened.
Looking for as well. They're not looking for what your failure was. They're looking for how you solved
overcame
it or
it.
What
yeah.
you learned, you know, and they're looking to see that you are self-motivated and that you can learn lessons from when you make mistakes, because we're all human. We're all going to make mistakes, and every job you ever have, you're going to make mistakes. You're going to let something fall through the cracks. You're not going to get something done, or you'll do it wrong. And they want to make sure that you've learned from it and that you're not going to let that happen again.
Mm-hmm. And that you're also just willing to own up to your mistakes. So
that you're willing to own up to your mistakes and not cover them up or slough them up on someone else. Because there's always that problem of people who don't ever take the blame for their mistakes, and they want to make everything somebody else's fault.
So, some of the other questions, that I think are the ones that people kind of get caught off guard, and I can say, like, I have probably bombed these questions every time, and it kind of goes back to, like, knowing the role or knowing the business, is, being able to ask questions at the end, because one of the questions that your interviewer is going to ask you is, do you have any questions? And I feel like if you say no I don't, then that draws a red flag as an interviewer, because then I'm thinking,
definitely
I have no idea what this person is thinking. Is it like cobwebs up there, or do they care, do they not care, do they
are
think
they just
they
showing
know?
Up for the paycheck and that's
or
it?
Do they think they know everything?
Oh, there's
you
that
know,
too. Yeah.
And they're not willing to
always
learn.
Always come up with 3 to 5 questions to ask in an interview.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You probably won't get to ask all of them.
And they may answer some of them, too.
Exactly. But always come up with 3 to 5 questions. And when I was doing, back in the day, mini teacher interviews, one of the questions that I always like to ask were things that were important to me in my classroom, like technology. So I would always ask what their policies for technology were on campus. Did the students have laptops? What was the technology like in the classroom for the teacher?
Oh,
that's a really good thought, too, because when you think about it, there's a lot of different things that people value in the workplace. Like, we've talked about personal values, you know, just my own person, like, oh, I believe in stability and balance and cleanliness and organization and pet rights, animal rights, right? Or whatever, like, just some examples. But when you think about the workplace, there's other things that people value, like the ability to be promotable, or What is the work-life balance? Right.
Do they expect you to stay late every night to get the work done? Or,
right. Yeah. What is the overtime policy? Some people like overtime. Like me, I'm like, if we have 5 hours of overtime that we're allowed to do, I'm going to be there working it because I want to get the extra money and get my work done right. or get ahead.
But some people want that
and some people don't want
9 to 5 or
overtime.
Yeah.
And they want to hear you say that there's no overtime available.
Right.
Some people want to hear, like, we take hour lunches so that, you know, you get plenty of time away from your desk. And some people want to know about the work culture. Like,
I was going to mention
you know,
that one.
Do you guys have office parties? Do you celebrate birthdays?
Right. Is this,
that's
is this a fun, relaxed place
well.
To work?
What's
or
the
is
work
it?
Culture yeah. like? Yeah. That's a good question to ask.
Yeah. You can also ask what the company does for the community. Just to see, you know, what.
Are there any charitable organizations that the company supports? Or do you have any groups or, you know, things like that, that cultural groups or anything like that, that the company sends people to, you know,
that would be a boon question in your favor as well, because some companies like to talk about their charitable works
yes.
and the things that they do for the community. That'll get them in a frenzy with talking to you. And those are, I think, the best kind of interviews when they're just a natural conversation.
Right.
And when the person that's interviewing you is excited about the company, too.
Well, and that tells you a lot about the company as well. And that's when you're in a job interview, they are not only interviewing you, you are interviewing them.
Yes.
To see if
it
it's
not
a place.
A one-way.
Right.
Grill and drill, yeah.
Right. You're trying to determine if this is a place where you want to work.
Right.
And by talking to them, if they're enthusiastic about their the place of employment and they're trying to communicate that to you, that tells you this might be a place that I might like. So
yeah, that's always
really
a
good
thing to look for is their enthusiasm. Because if you're just interviewing with somebody that's just like, well, blah, 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 and then, you know, you ask a question, well, blah, blah, then it's just kind of like, well, they don't enjoy working here, so why should I work here?
Right, right.
So speaking of blah, 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 what about body language?
Oh, yeah. Body language is a very important. So,
for me, body language is very important. Like, somebody has to have, like, I don't know, the vibe. That's like my biggest thing when I'm interviewing or if I'm talking to somebody is the vibe. It might not even be the body language, but it's how I feel around that person.
But as we're speaking, I'm looking at you and both of us have our hands crossed.
Yeah, you're.
That is like a signal that you are closed.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Amber's are crossed over her lap at the desk very professionally.
Yes, yes. But that is one of the body language things is that when you cross your legs or cross your ankles or you cross your hands across your chest or anything like
that.
Oh,
yeah, especially if you have your arms
folded. That's a symbol that you are closed.
A lot of times when I cross my arms, it's because I don't know what to do with my arms and I don't want them hanging
well,
by my
side.
Well,
you see what I'm usually doing with my hands.
My tip for
move.
You, Amber, is when you go to an interview, then you should have pen and paper handy and then
and
you
make
should
notes.
Make
Use
notes.
Use your
because
hands
then
yeah. Notes.
Your hands are doing something productive that shows interest.
Yes.
Well, I'm just sitting here doing this podcast.
Yeah.
I cross my arms or legs.
Well,
at
no,
there are people who lean back in a chair and cross their arms over their chest and cross their legs. And that is a body language that shows you're disinterested and you're closed off.
Okay.
And that's not helpful. So
don't let an interviewer do that to you then. Like,
I
want to
talk about some things that people, since I was in HR, you know, I saw people do this a lot. Some things that annoyed me a lot. And that is attire, how you show up for your interview. So the way that you show up to an interview is important. And you need to know the culture of the place that you work at. it used to be kind of an unwritten rule that you dressed up to go to an interview. But if you're going to go interview at McDonald's, you do not have to wear a suit and tie. But you should dress appropriately. You should not show up in jeans and a t-shirt.
Or like jeans and a ripped t-shirt.
Or a ripped t-shirt, right.
No t-shirt. It should be a polo shirt at minimum.
It should be some kind of button-up shirt and slacks. So, or a blouse if you're a woman. You could show up in a dress, but it's not necessary. Slacks is fine. But also, know the culture of the place you're working. Know whether they accept tattoos, piercings, colored hair, because that's a very common thing nowadays. People have different colored hair, and not every job place accepts those personal choices. And so you need to know whether that is part of that culture or not before you interview.
Food industry interview experience. Actually, this, you just triggered some memory that was buried way deep. You dress for what the role is.
Right.
And you said, you know, you were talking about McDonald's as an example, and I did work in a fried chicken restaurant, and
but
I
did not wear jeans.
No. Let me finish. So I went to my interview dressing in, before that I was working as in a restaurant in management. So I was, you know, trying to dress very professional for this fast food restaurant. And I actually wore a dress. It was like a skirt, not a full body dress. It was like a skirt with a blouse. And that actually was a problem for the person interviewing me, because they were afraid that that was part of my cultural attire.
Oh, right.
And so she was like, she pulled me aside and she was like, before I continue with the interview, I just want to make sure, you know, do you normally wear dresses? Because this is no pants, or this is pants only. And she was actually like hesitant to continue the interview because she wanted to make sure that that wasn't going to be like a no-go for me, because there are some people culturally that only wear dresses,
right.
And for a fast food restaurant, a dress is not appropriate.
It could be dangerous.
And she was actually worried that it would be like a cultural thing. So she had to stop and ask me that, like, kind of on the side. And then I realized, why did I wear a dress? Like, you know, and in that, I thought about like the shoes. I don't remember what kind of shoes that I wore, but think about like if you're going to work in a restaurant or, you know, applying for a job and you're having an interview, you would want to wear footwear that's appropriate for the job as well. So you wouldn't want to go in with like high heels or open-toed shoes,
right,
for your interview, because if they are also giving you a tour of the facility,
you need to be safe when you go through
exactly,
the kitchen.
And if they can't give you a tour, then that's also going to hinder your ability to interview the company as well, because you would want to be able to take part in
and that's why I say like slack, you know, like if you're going to a fast food restaurant, because normally if you work at a fast food restaurant, you're wearing like khakis or black slacks or something like that.
If it's your first time ever going to interview, you might not know. Yeah.
Right. So that's a, you know, a good point. And, but also if, you know, if you're going to work in, to interview for an office, then of course, dressier attire would be more appropriate.
Yes.
And like I said, be aware of the culture. Be aware about jewelry, because too much jewelry can also be a problem in the workplace, because depending on, you know, what you're doing, if you work in a call center and you have to wear a headset, you're probably not going to be able to wear big dangly earrings. And, and if you have big dangly earrings that make a lot of noise when you move your head, that's probably not a good thing to wear to a job interview.
I was always told rule of five.
Five
pieces of jewelry. So
one earring, two earring,
a necklace, bracelet, and a ring.
Or a watch. So, yeah, and you want to keep it, you know, light. You don't want to wear this big, huge, chunky.
Yeah.
You know, if you're
like
going to work in a fast food
necklace.
Place, yeah, you don't want to wear a big, chunky necklace that could get caught in machinery or something like that or whatever.
And let's talk about nails while we're at it.
Oh, that's another good one. Yes.
Nails. If you're applying for a job that is computer or food, I'm sure there's other jobs where you also should not have long acrylic nails. So I would advise, if you're still going to continue wearing nails, to just go for shorter and more
professional looking.
And not even just, I wouldn't say professional, I would just say more modest.
Yes, yes.
So,
but also not just the length of the nails, but also the cleanliness of the nails, because I can't tell you how many people have come in to apply for jobs that had grungy looking nails, and you know, they haven't cleaned under them, or their cuticles are ratty looking,
or unwashed hair.
Oh yeah, that too.
Mm-hmm. At least brush your hair.
Yeah,
goodness.
And then along those lines, also, don't go overboard with perfumes.
Actually, they say not to wear perfume.
You should not wear perfume at all
to an interview, because you don't know if that person's going to be allergic.
Right. And they are trying to teach. You know, we're trying to let people. We're trying to be more aware of people who have those sensitivities. But you really should not wear perfume to that interview.
And the reason why is maybe they're not allergic, but they may find it a little displeasing to the nose. And what ends up happening is
it's that they don't like.
It's overpowering their ability to pay attention.
Right, right.
And so at the end of the interview, your sense of smell is your strongest memory. So if they didn't come away from that interview feeling the most best and positive about your interview, they're going to remember.
Oh, yeah. She was the one that stank.
Yeah. And then you're going to be like known as the stinky interview person.
Or the oh my God, she wore so much perfume.
Because it's going to outweigh everything
and
else.
And that goes for men too, because men wear aftershave and cologne and don't realize how much of it. If you can smell it on yourself, you have too much on, because you're not supposed to be able to smell it yourself. It's just supposed to be a light oil that blends with your own body heat to create a small fragrance.
You're not supposed to like make a cloud go behind you as you walk by.
Right. Right.
Just, yeah. Or permeate the room.
If you smell it yourself,
if you
can smell it on yourself,
I teach teenagers. So I'm just like teenage boys going through puberty. Like they carry these big things of cologne in their backpacks.
Well, I think part of that's because they really stink too.
Oh, well, yeah.
They just smell.
They just smell.
Like,
right.
I have one student that has to go to the bathroom at least once a day and put lotion and stuff like that on good smelling stuff. Because
I remember Axe when my son was, he didn't wear it, but his several of his friends would wear Axe, and that stuff is so strong smelling, and they would just like, so bad. So bad.
The, what's that other brand? Old Spice. Axe.
Old Spice.
Oh my God.
That one I think is like a, there are some of those scents, like even Axe, Old Spice, all of those Stetson, those are like, if you love it, you love it. If you hate it, or you don't, if you don't love it, you probably hate it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they're very strong. They are very strong. And that's the point.
You don't want to be deemed Old Spice man or Axe boy.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and like I say, like, you know, like Amber was saying about the hair, wash your hair. Make your hair clean. Make sure it's dry. Don't show up to an interview
with wet hair
like you just took a bath.
Like you waited until the last minute to come to your interview. So that's one of the things I wanted to say was plan your day out. So if you're going to be at an interview, there is nothing wrong with showing up way early and just sitting in your car and waiting.
As long as you're not sweating.
As long as you're not sweating.
As long as it's not 100 degrees.
Yeah, if it's
now, don't go in way early.
No,
either,
don't
though.
Go way early. You can be there a little bit early.
It's okay to be there 5 minutes early.
Yes, but it's
if
totally
early,
not okay to be
time.
5 minutes late. Thank you. But the problem is that if you're not sure if you're going to be there on time or early and you're not sure, just arrive early and hang out somewhere or get close to the place. And find somewhere where there's air conditioning if it's hot outside and you don't have air conditioning in your car. You know, whatever. To kill some time until you get there.
Yeah.
Take a block around and see what all's around the area.
Oh, yeah. So, that's a great opportunity to check out what kind of places you could go for lunch if you work there. Or
exactly.
Transit options and things like mm-hmm. that. So, mm-hmm.
Just sit in your car if you have air conditioning. And do some positive affirmations or something to relax yourself.
Meditation.
Because the worst thing is the rushing there and you're out of breath. And then you finally get there and you're like having anxiety about getting there. And then, boom, you're in this interview that also causes anxiety. Well, so give yourself that pause
I like doing that too, and that was where you were talking about do a little meditation or something. They call it tactical breathing, or sometimes they call it boxed breathing or square breathing, where you inhale to the count of four, you hold it to the count of four, you exhale to the count of four, and then you hold at the count of four, and you just keep doing that until you've kind of calmed your mind. And that's a great way to get yourself set up for that interview. It helps, especially if you have a little bit of anxiety, that will help kind of calm you down and get you in that right frame of mind. And I'm a huge proponent of, doing that little bit of meditation or breathing exercises just to get yourself in that right place.
All right. So, one of my last tips for being prepared, something that you do before you go to the interview, and probably something you should do before you start applying for jobs. Like, everyone should just stop what you're doing right now and go through your Facebook history and delete all of the stupid stuff you said.
Oh, gosh. Yes.
Or anything that might put you in a bad light.
Right.
Or make you look a little messy or a little dramatic.
Or too young. Or too immature.
Update your profile picture. Update your relationship status. Although, I can say, like, jobs should not be judging you based on that. But your online presence is important in the workday now.
Yes.
And they do look on Facebook and other websites see if you have an online presence to determine if you are, a candidate for someone that they would like to hire, because they don't want to hire messy people that have dramatic things going on.
Or if you've got the same picture that you had on since you were in high school, they don't want to see that either. So that, your LinkedIn profile as well, your Instagram profile, remove anything that is compromising. It's probably just a good idea not to post that stuff to start with, but if you want to be professional, but
just kind of forget about that stuff. If you're like Amber and I, we've had Facebook since 2005,
right?
And we're going on almost 20 years of being on Facebook.
Oh my gosh, to think about that.
I know. And so it is a healthy idea to unfollow things that don't resonate with you anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Just do a little bit of digital cleanup in the world. One that I just thought about because of one of Amber's BFFs. She gave me her email address the other day, and she said she had a grown-up email address because it was her first and last name. And that is really important in appearing like a mature individual to have a professional email address. Stick with, your first and last name, or maybe a number or two or a middle initial or a period to make you stand out from all the other people with their first and last name. But I highly recommend that. And I also recommend, if you still want to keep your kitty cat goes wild email address, if you still want to keep that one, then go make another one just for jobs and your work. And that way you can provide a professional email address. So update your Facebook, update your LinkedIn, update your resume, get a relevant email address that's not full of spam and is adultish, and make sure you have appropriate wardrobe for your interview. Start working on your questions and answers and practice with a friend. And map out the directions of where your interview is at so that you are punctual.
Yeah, I think that's a great, great idea. Those are great tips.
Anybody else have anything else that I left off?
No, I mean, that sounds good to me.
Yeah, I think we've covered all the things that used to drive me crazy when people came in the door.
So I have a question for our listeners. What is one question that you would ask in your interview?
Oh, what would they ask if they were applying for a job?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or if you were interviewing someone also, I'll throw that one out there too.
Yeah.
What question would you ask a potential candidate? I know that my boss at my job, he always throws out the question that makes people, like, you know, kind of like cower. And because he likes to put them on the spot and see how, you know, they are under pressure.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember the question that was asked of me was, they gave me a clicky pin and they said, sell this pin to me. And I was not expecting that, I think I rocked it. So,
okay. That's interesting.
Yeah. So be prepared for, you know, I did not think working for a call center or for a dental company that I would need to be able to sell a pen.
But that is what you do. I mean,
it is what I do. Absolutely. It just, my mind didn't even think about that.
Yeah. I get that. I can see that. It's kind of funny because somebody was, I was watching a video the other day, and they were talking about the questions that they hate in interviews or anything like that. And one of them was, where do you see yourself in 5 years? Or where do you see yourself in 10 years?
Why do you hate that so much? Because you don't have an answer. There's a bigger problem than you needing a job.
Right. Well, I don't know. You know, that one is a hard one, though.
Because it really is.
It really is for a lot of people.
Because when you say it out loud, it becomes an expectation.
Right.
And so when you are not ready to say, where do I see myself in 5 years, then that means that there are some insecurities about what you're doing right now and where you're going with it. So it's definitely something to work on. I was actually saying, like, wow, I think a lot of these interview questions are really good, like shadow work questions. Like,
oh, absolutely.
What are your strengths and weaknesses? Or talk about a time where you failed and you overcame the failure. Or what is it that you're looking for in a job? I'm not going anywhere in my job. I love my job. I love my career path. But, like, how often do I sit down and think, like, what do I want out of my job?
Right.
Besides, I'm not just there collecting a paycheck.
Right. Hopefully, you know? Nobody is there just collecting a paycheck.
Right. So
that's
what
not
is
the
it
kind
that
of
you
people
want?
People want to hire. So
why that you should be able to passionately say, this is what I want out of my job, and be able to talk to your boss about that.
Yeah.
Because your boss is there to help you get that.
Right.
Make that job fulfilling for
right.
you.
So exactly.
I think these are good questions asked.
My husband used to say, when people asked him what he did for a living, he said he was an audio engineer, and he worked on commercials and music and things like that. And one of his favorite things to say was that he felt like he never worked a day in his life. And I think that is, if you find the right job for you, that is the way you should feel about your job. Like, you haven't worked a day in your life, that you're doing what you love to do, no matter what it is, whether it's leading other people, whether it is selling products that you find value in, whether it is performing a service or creating something or whatever. Find the job that makes you feel like you haven't worked a day in your life. And when somebody asks you, in an interview, what you want, that's your answer. Mm-hmm. I want to find the place. I want to be working at the place that makes me feel like I haven't worked a day in my life. I want to be doing what I love. And what I love is
blah, blah, blah.
You fill in the blank.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah.
I like it. All right. So what are we talking about next week?
Next week, we are talking about houseplants and how I kill them.
So we're going from work growth to plant growth.
Plant growth or stunted growth.
Right.
Something like that.
So
die in a pot alone.
I'm looking forward to that because I don't know why. I'm not very good at plants. Maybe we could get some tips from you guys for my plants or something. I don't know. I love the idea of plants, but
yeah. Our topic should be now changed to how to not houseplant.
Oh, there we go. There we go. I'm just working on how not to face plant, you know.
Right.
All right.
Well, we look forward to connecting with you guys again next week. We do want to thank Creative Audio Tech for our music, and we want to keep that conversation going. So we'd love to hear your take on this episode or any of the questions that we, I know we barely even scratched the surface on questions. Like actual interview questions, because there's so much that goes into this like 30 minute meeting that you have that determines like your destiny with a company. There's so many questions and so many different tips we probably didn't even cover. So I'd love to hear what our listeners have to think. And don't forget to check us out on modernmusings.net, where we have blogs and also information on our podcast. Each individual episode will have additional links and supplemental information that you can check out there. All right. Well, we will pick up our conversation next week. Looking forward to chatting with you again. Goodbye.
Bye.